just wanted to take a few moments to thank our panelists and moderators from our conference and their insightful visions about how we might connect how we might connect Asian American studies to CUNY, the CUNY community and the larger New York City population. My name is Trevor Lee, and I'm a PhD candidate here at the CUNY Graduate Center, and I served as a fellow at the Asian American Asian Research Institute and as the assistant editor for CUNY Forum. And as someone who grew up west of the West Coast in Hawaii, I didn't understand the concept of Asian American until I left home, as Hawaii is the only API majority state with 60% of its population being Asian Pacific Islander. It's when I moved to Texas that I first felt like a minority and started to experience forms of racism that were new to me. But by the time I entered the CUNY Graduate Center, I had a hunger to better understand my racialized position as an Asian within the larger United States. And as was alluded to by some of our earlier panelists, there's no institutionalized Asian American Studies department at the Graduate Center. But what quickly became clear to me is that there's an abundance of supportive Asian American researchers and faculty within and throughout the CUNY system. The Asian American Asian Research Institute was formative in my growth as a scholar, as it became an important convening of university-wide scholarly researchers, research and resources that focus on policies and issues that affect Asians and Asian Americans. Their weekly evening lecture series highlighted the community-based research of CUNY faculty from the 24 campuses, modeling what it means to be an activist scholar. It was also important to see how the staff at ARI worked tirelessly to bring together a community of scholars that supports the study of Asian Americans at CUNY and to disseminate meaningful research to the public. When Russell Leong came to ARI in 2011 as a Thomastown visiting professor, he rummaged through the archives of ARI, noting the abundance of transcripts and recorded lectures of scholars who had passed through the doors of ARI. It was then that he began to envision a publication that would showcase Asian American studies at CUNY, but also highlight Asian American research on the East Coast more broadly. A few years ago, Russell helped ARI to develop a bulletin that highlights the history of ARI and its position within Asian American studies. And last year, Russell proposed an annual publication labeled CUNY Forum to present the research, the current research of CUNY faculty. The goal of this publication is 3 C's: communities, cultures, and commons. In other words, bringing intellectual and cultural communities together in a new commons beyond mainstream Asian American typecasting. I was happy to work on this publication with Russell, Anthony, William, Zhu, and Joyce, because in many ways, this publication brings together and documents the wealth of resources within CUNY that were formative to my own graduate studies by emphasizing critical modes of thinking and community-based research. This past summer, I had the opportunity to use the inaugural issue in my Intro to Asian American Studies course at Hunter. And it became an invaluable resource for discussion, linking broader and theoretical issues to the personal daily experiences of my students. From these class discussions, I came to see this publication as an important step in CUNY's 166-year history, as it establishes a platform for scholarly discussions about Asian American issues, but in a way that becomes accessible to the community that this research seeks to serve. So I'll go ahead and present Russell Leong. Russell Leong is an award-winning prose and poetry writer and editor of UCLA's Asian American Journal and China Media Brief. He was featured with 50 US poets on the PBS series, The United States of Poetry. He also taught at UCLA, the University of Kansas, China, Japan, Taiwan, and most importantly, CUNY Hunter College. I should also mention that he hails from Silver Lake, California, the hippest town in the United States, according to Forbes magazine.
Okay, thanks. Sorry about being from the West Coast. I know this is an exclusively, East of California gathering, but, you know, infiltration. Anyway, thanks for coming. The reason why we had Trevor speak, our assistant editor, we put the good first, and I think we want to end with Peter. Because Peter's going to be more critical, right, Peter? Of course.
Yes.
Yeah, being the social, we need a social critic. We can't just have all this good stuff. So I'd like to just introduce some of the people. Of course, we know Peter, After me, Jennifer, John, Luis will say a few words. I kind of got him to speak, and then we'll open it up. First of all, let me just say, CUNY Forum is actually just a new kid on the block. It's not the first East Coast publication by far. Actually, AmerAsia Journal was started at Yale by Yale undergraduates Lowell Chun-Hoon and Don Nakanishi. Then it moved to UCLA. Bridge was founded here in New York City, in a bridge and the basement workshop. The Asian American Policy Review comes out of Harvard, and the Journal of Asian American Studies is published by John Hopkins. So CUNY really is the newest kid on the block. So that means we can be the baddest, right? Because we're the newest. But like, why another forum in Asian American Studies? Most people actually just download their what they want to read on their cell phones, on their smartphones, right? So if you actually fill out your survey, you'll get a free copy of this, $15. Two Starbucks, two or three cups of coffee, you get it for free. Just turn in your survey at the front desk. Okay, well, here's the bad stuff. Working through the grapevine, I had heard before I came to New York that people on the East Coast, and also from my own experience, wanted to have a forum that would address the needs of East Coast scholars, communities, activists, researchers. And it's not that, you know, Asian American Studies is so new on the East Coast. In fact, there's a bunch of East Coast Studies programs, whether at UPenn, I think it's celebrating its 15th year, Hunter, its 20th year, also at NYU and also the University of Massachusetts. However, from my observations, the East Coast is very turf-driven, and many college and institutions were competing for the same grants and similar recognition. I remember about, I don't know, maybe 30 years or so when I first came to New York, I went to Chinatown and the various places where a lot of the Asian American organizations were. And they just basically talked, well, anyway, it starts with an S and ends with a T, about each other. So I was really surprised that basically all these organizations within a two-mile square radius were so competitive and very turf-driven. So I was wondering, working together might be difficult in New York City. However, I consider myself both as an outsider to the East Coast programs, but also an insider in terms of Asian American studies. So I thought, well, maybe it's time to do something. And with Ari's support, we made the first issue happen. I figured the worst that could take place was that I'd be driven out of New York by a bunch of Asians. But I took my cue from President Obama. Reach out across the aisle until the going gets tough and then just stand your ground. It's worth a try. Anyway, I just wanted to say that actually, even though I am from the West Coast, actually, I was trying to figure out my own history, and in the early 1980s, I actually first met Peter Kang and Shirley Hewn and many others who were attending the Asian American Studies Conference at Hunter. At that time, Madhulika Khandelwal took me on a tour of Hindu temples in Queens, just under construction. Then a few years later, the English department had flew me out for a job, which I did not get. Mina Alexander was already making waves. Louise Francia was a well-known literary scholar and poet. Labor historian Peter Kwong was at UCLA for a spell. And so was sociologist Pyeonggap Min, whom I got to know very well. And much later, Robert Koo, who was my student in English at UCLA and the ex-director, right, of Asian American Studies at Hunter. And of course, Betty Lee Sung, the legend, who actually knew my dad before I was born, right, Betty? So you were actually talking with my dad before I was born. So, you know, it seems that these are kind of old friends in a sense. Anyway, since Trevor had already talked about the contents of CUNY Forum, and our goal is basically to have always cover Asian American studies, global thinking, community research, and CUNY forms, or literary and cultural studies. Future issues, because once something is published, it's already the past. Future issues, which we are considering right now, our first essay came in, which is a bibliographical essay on public access websites on Asian American and Asian studies websites of images and materials available to the public. And it's written by a librarian who was formerly at the New York Public Library and now a research librarian at NYU's new campus in Shanghai. We also will feature oral history of the earliest Korean Americans in New York City in the late 19th century, and also the first Koreans who were enslaved in Yucatan, Mexico at the turn of the 20th century. We're also looking at the connection between the indigenous tribes of Taiwan and their relation to Pacific Islanders, Native Americans, and Asian Americans. And this is sort of, we'll ask some tough questions about the hegemony of, you know, kind of U.S.-China relations as it's now situated. So we're both going to be local and transnational. A few points I wanted to bring up before the others speak is that I wanted just to bring up the fact that when I first started working at UCLA in 1977, at the beginning of my academic career, remember, there was no computer, no internet, no Wikipedia, no cell phone, and no virtual downloadable world. Can anyone think of a world without those things? No, right?
Didn't have a car either.
Oh, no, I didn't have a car, and I didn't start driving until I was in my 30s, and it was like a Chinese driver, you know, the kind you have to avoid. But anyway, those things did not exist, which leads to the question today in terms of Asian American research, whether it's community studies, cultural studies, whatever, how do we best publish and disseminate knowledge around Asian and Pacific Islanders? Is print still the best way, or is it obsolete? Or do potential readers, prefer reading online, downloading on your smartphone, or Kindle, or iPads? And the other larger question, can academic and traditional academic approaches to scholarship better utilize new technology? So let me have a show of hands. I'm going to take a survey here. Are you satisfied with reading a academic essay just printed on paper? Paper, okay. Or do you want to know about the person? Do you want to see an interview with the person, like online or on the web? Okay, on web, okay. Would you prefer not reading print? Would you prefer just to see the computer version, electronic version? Okay. Oh, I don't know why I'm raising my hand. I like all of them, okay. Anyway, nowadays, both in academia, in journalism, in all kinds of media, there's a shifting line between content and context, politics and personality, and so forth. Even in the New York Times, major journalists have blogs, Twitter, email, so you can interact with them to a point. Should scholars also be more open to interactive communication? Raise your hand. Scholars and researchers, would you like to like communicate and email, Twitter? Okay, all of you need to have Twitter accounts, email, and whatever, so we can talk with you like 24/7. Okay, the reason why I'm asking these questions is because in order for something like the forum to survive, this is an old-fashioned print format, but how do we really survive? How do we reach people? And we may have to use new technology and things that are not even invented yet. So these are some of the things that I wanted to raise, because I don't know the answers. So hopefully you out there and all of you can help us to find some answers and also raise new questions about scholarship, publishing, dissemination, and the future. Thank you.
I'm not sure what to say, but anyway, I'll take a stab. I'm very glad to see CUNY Forum. It's partly because I'm in it. A writer always loves to see his or her work in print. But that aside, it's well within a tradition that I'm aware of in New York. I go back to Bridge. You know, it was quiescent for a while. And it was revived with Asian Cinevision that took over. It was originally, as Russell pointed out, put out by the Basement Workshop and then for whatever reason, it, you know, basically was out of print, and ACV took over. I became involved with a number of other writers, and that was a eye-opening experience. And shortly before that, I was involved with a anti-martial law magazine in English. The title means brush fire. But the original title was actually quite funny. It was called Imelda's Monthly. Because the founder's first name was also Imelda. And it was founded in Manila just before martial law was declared, and therefore the magazine had to go underground, and the older sister of the founder lives in New York, and she resurrected it and asked me and a number of other Filipino writers to be part of it. So willy-nilly I was thrust into being political, because until that point I was happy as a clam, didn't really want to be involved, but events back home and through a number of circuitous events got involved with Bridge and with the Asian American scene here. And at the time, of course, speaking of the West Coast, the literary scene seemed to be dominated by writers on the West Coast, mostly men. And so with Bridge, it was kind of a, not necessarily a counterweight, but something that helped to establish, along with Amerasia Journal, the Asian American literary tradition on the East Coast. So, you know, I hope all of you buy copies, subscribe to, whether in hard copy or online. I'm from the Ice Age. I love hard copy. For one reason, you can throw it down, you can kick it around, you can write on it, you can bring it to the bathroom, you can do all sorts of things that you may not be able to do with your Kindle. So yes, it's great, and I encourage all of you to participate, be a community. And I guess that's one way that the online access allows readers to be much more interactive. And for that reason, you know, I welcome the fact that it will be, is it available online?
Anthony, will it be available online soon? Oh, soon, okay.
Yeah, the moment it becomes available online, I hope that that will draw a wider audience. Thanks.
Thank you, Luis. I wanted to mention this print version is very durable. We were burning it before somebody's ancestral grave. It took half an hour to burn because this paper is especially coated with chemicals, so it's very difficult to burn. So if you threw your Kindle on top of an ancestral grave and set fire to it, it would be destroyed. But this took like half an hour to burn. So rest assured that your copy of CUNY Forum is long-lasting. Okay. Jennifer?
So I just have a few comments to make. First of all, I want to say thank you to Russell for spearheading this effort, which has been a long time in the making in terms of talking about its necessity, but it took Russell to actually realize it. So I think he deserves a hand just for that. Because I know that doing this kind of thing is like herding cats. I guess the thing I want to say sort of briefly isn't about my contribution, but is about the function of CUNY Forum as I see it, which has to do with building community around the scholarship and teaching that we do. CUNY, to me, is a very, it's an amazing place. Our students are complicated and exciting to work with, and we have great colleagues in our faculty and our adjunct faculty, but it's also a very alienating place, both for students and faculty. And I think that something like the forum serves this incredibly important function as a hub, right? As a platform both, going back to the earlier panel, both to communicate research to the various communities of New York City and beyond, and to find a way to make our research or our ideas or our poetry available. But the other thing I think the forum does, or at least does for me, thinking about how I read it when I read it, is that it allowed me to be in conversation with faculty who I don't see, who I might never have met them, but they're doing this incredibly important research at other CUNY institutions. And it, first of all, as director of the AASP, it's obviously important for me to know about the research that they're doing. But secondly, just as someone who cares deeply about education and about CUNY and about New York City, it was so exciting for me to be in this silent dialogue, if you will, with everyone who had contributed to the issue. And I think that functionality needs to be emphasized, because, like I said, I think CUNY is a very difficult place a lot of the time. And I think for those of us who are working sort of on the margins, or who aren't quite sure where we fit in terms of both the institutional framework and our respective disciplines, I think something like the forum is very important in terms of allowing us to communicate with each other as scholars across a range of disciplines and practices. And so for that, I'm very, very grateful, because to me, this is something that's sorely needed. And I think, regardless of what the next iteration of the forum looks like, if it's print or if it's online or if it's both, I'm frankly an all of the above kind of person. I want to be able to read things in multiple ways, but I think the fact that it serves as this hub is incredibly important, and I think that it's critical to sustaining Asian American studies at CUNY, because it will allow us to talk to each other about how to think creatively around Asian American studies curriculum, scholarship, program building, student engagement, and so on. So thank you.
Okay, let me just add that, you know, the CUNY forum has expanded past the local. We actually had sent to colleagues in places like in Beijing and Taipei and other places outside of the U.S., and they're quite excited about it because they want to have more information about Asian Americans as well. So surprisingly, you know, something small could actually have influence, because people are hungry for knowledge about Asian Americans as Asian Americans become more influential. And of course, for instance, in China, they have to deal with Gary Locke, right? Our own Asian American, they can't quite understand him. So a lot of times with the butterfly effect, you know, small things may have some consequences. John?
Okay. Well, I'm not gonna say too much. You've heard a lot from me this afternoon. And actually, Jennifer said so much of what I was feeling when I read CUNY Forum. You know, when I first got involved in this, I didn't know what it was gonna be like. And when I sort of delved into it, and I loved the print edition just because it's sort of immersive with all the photos and everything in the layout. I really felt like I was part of an Asian American studies community. I really felt that. And it really embodies what I was talking about earlier, this marriage between the humanities, community research, and also thinking about Asian American studies as a discipline. I was really touched by Betty Lee Sung's opening article about the founding of Asian American Studies at City College, and also really disheartened to hear that it basically ended when she retired. And then learning about from Jennifer about the statistics of how many Asian American students there are at the different campuses, and what a travesty it is that we don't have Asian American Studies at the various CUNY campuses. So it's a really wonderful primer, I think, for Asian American Studies, a really excellently pitched first edition. And as we think about community and this being a vehicle for building community, I love the idea of having sort of an online presence with more interaction that way. And the last thing I wanted to say was, we were talking about branding this morning, and I know that's a little bit controversial, but this is a wonderful way to brand Asian American Studies at CUNY. It's a really nice face, I think, for the larger scholarly community, but also our communities out there in New York and beyond.
Okay, thank you. So for all of you who like it so much, hopefully we can commit you to use it as part of your class syllabus eventually, right?
Right.
Okay, you heard it.
This is way too formal for a celebration of a magazine. And everybody scattered all over the place, and the light is really shining on us. But anyway, I actually am like to use this occasion, celebration, the first issue of CUNY Forum, to celebrate Russell Leung. Russell should be celebrated for a number of reasons. One of them, of course, Russell as an editor. You know, I know Russell from way back, but for a long time, I never really, you know, I seen his work in the office at UCLA. I never really knew what he does. And, you know, obviously after 30 years of really distinguished publishing career, you know, you really respect him. But still, I don't know who Russell is as editor until I realized that that he was able to corral a bunch of academic to produce an article for a magazine that nobody knows anything about and knowing any future possibility. And you're not going to be, you know, it's not even a referral journal, all those things.
Yeah.
So I was really surprised that it came off. When he first asked me, it was one of those weird things. You know, I have no time. I mean, I don't even have time. I'm guilty about all the articles I have not written yet. And he's asking me to write another article and about something quite personal. And I said to myself, geez, you know, I will try it. But I was hoping I never have to worry about the deadline because it won't never happen. But then he's telling me, he says, you're the last one. So I did come out with the articles. So the point is that he's got some extraordinary power of persuasion, able to make people feel guilty and write and come up with good stuff. And this has turned out to be a fantastic issue. And I know the amount of work he had put in it. He was, you know, every day was, I mean, after all those editing is done, he's editing improve and looking at prints and word by word and bitching about somebody misspelling something, et cetera, et cetera. That's why it's so good. Now, so the issue here is that not only he was the editor of the most prestigious Asian American magazine, now he's starting another one on the East Coast. And the first issue came out, it's going to be for real. So, and that's something that really, really is amazing. He's got a second career. Now, so let me tell you something. If Russell gonna ask you to write an article, you better do it. Because you're gonna be famous. Because you're gonna be in the journal that's gonna be respected. Now, so that's the first thing to celebrate. The second thing to celebrate Russell, actually, he stole a line from me before I start talking. That is, Russell is an outsider from Los Angeles, right? From the hippest place, second hippest place in the United States, or first hippest place? Okay, Silver Lake. So he's been in Los Angeles for 30-some years, and it seems that he's pretty stuck there, and yet he came here. And able to do things that none of us able to do. For all these years, there's a huge Asian American community, and yet we're all divided, scattered all over the place, right? Forget about all these other, even CUNY campuses, we have many, many campuses, we have huge number of faculty, very, very rarely we ever get a chance to meet. Maybe come to RE banquets, or even rarely to do that. But the point is that we really did not have an intellectual community to speak of. Well, here is this outsider coming around and start doing things, putting up events, able to get all these intellectual powers from not just CUNY faculty, but artists, writers outside of, in New York City area. And so here it is that he's putting us on, to shame that, well, you know, what have we been doing, right? Betty, you and me, we're the oldest around here. We always talk about Asian American studies and Native American and that. We're just pulling, you know, I mean, we were frustrated. We couldn't get anything really going. Here's this guy come here and did it. So this is really, really very, very important that we need this outsider, and although he's more insider than outsider now, he showed us that it's possible, and it's about time we really push forward to try to cut across all the campuses, cut across all the, you know, interdisciplinary lines, cut across the, you know, professional versus academic versus artists, and this is something that I think is very, very exciting. Now, and so what is more important for us to do is that, you know, Los Angeles is a great place to be, but it's a big place. You have to drive everywhere. And I know he's got a wonderful house in Silver Lake, but his heart really belongs to New York City. Just look at all the things he could do in New York City he could not do in California. And that's why I knew when I first, last year, I realized we have to find ways to make sure that he stay at least one more year in New York City. So we were able to get him 1 year financing, so he's staying here. But I hope we'll ultimately able to import him for good, because he will be a fantastic force for our region. And not just about this magazine. Magazine is a manifestation of what he could do. I would say some of the conferences, two or three conferences he put up together, are some of the best. That really is you know, I was, you know, quite excited that, you know, to know that I'm teaching with all bunch of CUNY faculty that's really very intelligent and friendly and all that. And also the vibrancy of New York region. So my end is to say this. I hope you're trying to be nice to him and try to encourage him to stay here, make Silver Lake a summer home or something like that, and he will stay here and we'll be able to work. And Russell, I hope you will think about it, and we will try every way possible to make sure that you're going to be able to stay here and very happily. Thank you.
Now, I don't believe in icons or people are forever. I basically believe that, you help facilitate the process, and hopefully you have better people taking over. That's the way it goes.
And I'm not building a cult of personality, Russell Leung, am I?
And thank you, Peter, for being a PR guy. But anyway, I think I see a lot of younger faces there, a lot of energy, actually. And hopefully one of you can actually help to bring this into the, a few more decades. And so let's kind of open it up. And I would like to hear what you would like to see in something like CUNY Forum. I mean, what would make you buy it? The next issue is not for free. You have to plunk down some bucks. So what's going to make you plunk down those bucks? Just go to the mic.
Well, I was thinking about all the other competitors that, like Black Americans, they have signed artist books and prints and artwork, and also big media coverage for their writers and performers. Maybe that's what is needed, more media blitz and online courses. I don't know. I mean, these are just ideas. And maybe the TV show Asia America could cover some of your activities. They're fantastic, and they're, I think they could reach huge audiences if they were put out into the mainstream.
That's Nina Gold, by the way. She has her two photographs in here, actually.
And there's tons of people that wanted to come today. They all told me, you know, they had prior commitments or teaching, or they're out of town. So I think they're here in spirit.
I think collaborations in the humanities and social sciences are essential. I see Ken Chen out there and the Asian American Writers Workshop, and we've done a number of programs together. And Ken Guess, who, along with Kalyang, wrote the article about Fujianese students at Baruch. So yeah, that's a great article, and hopefully you can assign it to your classes. Others? Any other speakers?
I do want to compliment all the writers and the editor. I had colleagues from Hong Kong University. They bought your book, Kingsley Ning and others. They were very impressed, and the statistics, the research that went into it was astounding. You know, bravo to all of you.
I think because I've already started to think of it as a teaching tool, and thinking about our introductory course, I think sort of selfishly, I'd like to see it organized thematically some future issue, thinking about it organized thematically around teaching and around teaching Asian American studies and teaching Asian American studies in New York City. You know, thinking about some of the things that came up here, Corky's suggestion regarding K-12 education, and questions around financial aid and student advocacy at community campuses, community college and senior college. You know, to have an issue of the forum reflect the pedagogy of Asian American studies. If that's one possible idea, just because I think it would be very useful both for us as faculty, but also for students to understand the sort of meaningful context behind their course. So that's one idea.
Yeah, one idea we had also was of establishing a group of donors instead of donating money for chicken dinners. No, although you should go to the Ari dinner banquet that's coming up, and that's not chicken, it's the Chinese food. But to have donors who donate money to basically, so we can donate copies to high school teachers, because I think it would be great for teachers to have a lot of basic information, including the timeline in back, an Asian American timeline of the East Coast developed by Trevor, Anthony, and Zhu in the back. And that's going to be interactive as well. So, you know, this kind of thing would be really useful for teachers at the K-12 level to have, and it's, you know, fairly digestible. I'd like to hear more about what other people would like to see in a journal like this. Since all of you are still here, you might be somewhat interested. Any others? Yeah, just go up to the microphone. Can you identify yourself as well?
Okay, first I want to congratulate the first issue of CUNY Forum, and I'm Kalyang from Brook College. I'm the co-author with Ken Guest. And I think the major reason I and Ken started the project and wrote that article was trying to decode the modern minority concept and try to uncover the hidden unequal treatment for Asian American group, and also address the hidden disadvantaged group within the Asian American group. So I think one of the issue why I got so interested in Asian American study was because Asian American as a group is so unfairly presented in media. Of course, I think the quality of research work published in this issue is wonderful. I'm very impressed. I think in the future, I will expect continues to to see those high quality scholarly work. But I also wonder if we can consider to incorporate some of the discussion on, say, the book, not necessarily scholarly book, for example, the Tiger Mom discussion. And those things may be may reflect more of the general discussion in the society about Asian American group and some of, for example, higher education and the educational opportunity for college students, our college students like this. So I think that will be very interesting.
Once again, my name is Corky Lee. I think some of the current issues that are taking place, last year you had Linsanity, this year you have a film. Probably an article on how does Linsanity part of Asian American studies and what impact does that have? You also have a Korean guy named Psy. You know, he came out with this song and dance last year. And, you know, the whole world basically found out about it. You know, what does that impact and how does that impact Asian Americans, you know, not just here in New York? Another thing might be, you know, there are other universities in New York City, just like Boston has a whole lot of universities. And have instructors, professors, you know, invite them to write too. I know that there's a PhD candidate in St. John's. She's writing. Well, it's not about Asian American. It's about she's writing, and it's about the fact that women from China, Japan, and Taiwan are postponing long-term relationships, or even think of getting married. You know, and there are different reasons, you know, for that. Okay. And on that note, I think, you know, a lot of sexual attitudes that Asians have about themselves, you know, that will get people to read. So you got a couple of ideas right there.
Any other suggestions? I think Betty, I think you had some. Or you want? Oh, okay. Yeah, Rose, what do you... Okay.
I think it would be interesting to feature interviews with faculty throughout CUNY to sort of highlight the work they're doing and to give that sort of personal sort of background on them, instead of just their scholarly work.
You said their personal... Yeah, actually, in a certain way, we've already begun doing that. For instance, we had, especially on the literary angle, we had a conversation with Louise Francia. It's available on the RA website. We just had a conversation with Mina Alexander. She talks not only about her poetry, but her life and her views on quite a number of issues. So John Chin actually has spoken at RA, and many of the people here, Ken Guess and Kaliang, their video, their presentation is actually available on the RE website. So I think that combination of both print and kind of using technology also to give you more insights into their research is good. And I think when you talk about personality and how they got into it, a video interview would be great. And it could be linked, of course, to the print version. So I think nowadays, from my observations, it's not an either or thing. It's a matter of both print and media. You know, I'd like to ask Ken Chen, of the director of the Asian American Writers Workshop, to say a few words about what you guys are doing in terms of what your thoughts about print and virtual media, because I know that you have a number of websites yourself and so forth.
Hi. So the Asian American Writers Workshop has three online magazines that we're slowly merging, and we're always looking for contributions. So if any of you guys are interested, I can give you my card or you can submit pieces. But one of them is called Open City, where we give fellowships to emerging Asian American writers, and then they go out into five Asian American neighborhoods, which are Flushing, Manhattan Chinatown, Jackson Heights, Sunset Park, and I can't remember the fifth one, but you get the idea. And I think Luis is teaching one of the pieces in his class on a balut eating contest, which I highly do not recommend you going to if you are a sensitive eater. But a lot of the stories concern things like gentrification, evictions in Chinatown, zoning issues. We did a lot of coverage of Hurricane Sandy, things around Islam. You know, it's sort of like showing ethnic communities as fundamentally like full of their own active creative life. The other two publications are The Margins, which is sort of more of like a avant-garde arts publication where we publish a lot of photography, visual art, poetry, a lot of cultural criticism. We're particularly trying to get more book reviews there. And we also have a project called Culture Strike, which is an attempt to start an immigrant rights art-based campaign where it started when we flew 50 writers and artists to Arizona, and for a week, like people like Maxine Hong Kingston and Danielle Arlacan, Teju Cole. So CultureStrike.net is like a magazine that publishes mostly poetry, reporting, essays, and fiction from like immigration, counterculture. So we've done a lot of collaborations with CUNY and Hunter. I think the online thing has been really interesting because it's allowed us to attract a large number of readers in a way that we wouldn't have been able to do if it were print, and it's much less expensive, though it has different types of expenses. So, for example, the workshop used to publish the Asian Pacific American Journal, which many people here, I'm sure, have been involved with. And like most literary magazines, a print run was pretty low. But with the workshops magazines, we've had a few pieces that have been able to kind of break out. Like Naima Hyman, who's an artist, wrote in a graduate student at CUNY, he wrote a piece about Bengali Harlem, Vivek Bald's new book about these immigrants from what is now Bangladesh who settled in Harlem in the early 20th century and kind of became part of the black community there. And, you know, a lot of people like Vijay Prashad and Paul Gilroy shared it. We got like 7,000 shares on Facebook. And it was actually a fairly academic, like dense piece. So I think we've learned a lot about what makes something interesting to people. How can you take something that's actually fairly academic or intellectual in nature and spread it? Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Trevor. I apologize because I can't hear too well, and so I want to answer Corky's question about the forum, because Carol Huang, who is my friend here, told me about what your question was. Now, the first one is, we're very fortunate to have Russell Liang come as editor, former editor of the Asian American Journal. My only complaint was that they mostly concentrated on the West Coast and ignore the East Coast entirely. So now he's here with us, and I am so grateful that he is here. Now, to talk about what is in the forum. Is that what your question was, Corky? Was that his question? What was the future questions of the forum? Now that we have a journal, you might say, of the Asian American research, I think it is very, very important that we utilize it to the utmost extent. And one thing that I think the forum should do is to bring as much research to the Chinese community as possible. And I think that in the past, all we did was talk about the Chinese in New York, in Los Angeles, in San Francisco, mainly San Francisco, and sometimes in Hawaii. But we are now discovering that there are lots and lots of Chinese and Asians in other cities, and we should really talk about them and bring this information to other Asian Americans. Now, the second thing that I would like very much to do is that the Asian American scene is changing, and we should bring this change to the Asian American public. Now, there were a lot of questions raised today about the younger generation and how they seem to be uninterested in Asian American studies and why it's important for us to offer Asian American studies in the colleges. And one thing that we did talk about was that, it's important to know where you came from and to know about your background. And most Asian Americans today will say, I'm not Asian American. And then when they come out into the larger society, they find out that they're not considered Americans, and that is when they have an identity crisis. And that is a very, very important thing for Asian Americans to realize and to study about their own background so that they know how to deal with themselves in a larger society. And one other thing that I have about to answer Corky's question is to deal with questions that we have never dealt with before. And that is, now that I'm considered one of the elderly, I think there are a lot of issues that concern the elderly that we have never raised before. And I think the forum is a good place to start. So with that, does that answer your question, Corky? You have to talk to me on the phone.
Thank you for your suggestions, Betty. But I wanted to, get more different types of stories, in there. One was about Linsanity, and another one had to do with why Psy's impact, his music, and was so important.
What did you say?
A couple of other things that came to mind as you were talking, Betty, was like, I noticed that MoCA, Museum of Chinese in America, in their permanent exhibit, has nothing about fortune cookies. Okay, now fortune cookies is actually very Asian American. It was actually Japanese that came up with the idea of having what we now call fortune cookie. It was it was called a tea cake, and those small fortunes were actually 24 different haiku poems. Now, majority of the audience probably doesn't know about that. But as a result of the Second World War, when Japanese Americans were put away in concentration camps, the Chinese took over the production of these tea cakes, but they couldn't call it tea cakes. So somebody came up with the term fortune cookie, and what we now have, it was smaller when the Chinese worked on it because of the shortage of flour and sugar back then. But, that's a part of American history that takes place, but it has a Japanese and an American element. So, stories like that people can relate to, because how often do we have Chinese food or any Asian food, stuff like that. I think that would be a worthwhile article.
Okay, thank you, Corky and Betty. I think also, as an editor, I've always felt that a publication should not only reflect the prevailing cultural say, norms or trends, but also ask some uncomfortable and unsettling questions. Otherwise, I mean, I think a publication's value is not always for us to be in the comfort zone, but to ask questions that may make us uncomfortable, because I think it's through this sort of, I don't believe that you have to, no pain, no gain, but I do believe that on the one hand, you know, Asian Americans are very comfortable in our assumptions, whether it's about politics, culture, gender, society, etc., and that our responsibility is to ask those questions that are not being asked as well. So not only reflect, as I said, current and prevailing trends, but to ask uncomfortable questions.
I think Russell answered the question very well, and the one thing that the forum should do is recognize that there are the Asian American group, which is a sort of a consortium of groups in the United States, that since we're included in it, that we should include them and talk about them, because a lot of this is a way to draw more and more Asians into our group. And I think the newer immigrant groups that have come to the United States lately merit a lot of our attention and research. So I think Russell is very much aware of that. Corky is aware of that, and I think we'll do well with the new forum. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, is that it? Okay. Why don't we give the, you know, actually what I wanted to say is that without the contributors and without our editorial board, which will be active in 2014, then we are really not a publication. Let me just thank all the staff, actually. This is not a one-person show. Let me thank everyone who was involved, including Trevor, Anthony Wong, William Tam, Zhu Hui Hu, and our publisher, Joyce Moy. Our editorial board, many of them could not be here. We offered them a free lunch, but we would not pay for their train or plane tickets. So let me read their names, who we seek advice from, and some of them also will act as referees, even though the first issue was only partially peer-reviewed, but all research in the forthcoming issues will be peer-reviewed, but not the essays or literature. So the members of our editorial board for spring 2014, and let's give them a hand, Mina Alexander, Mustafa Bayomi, Louise Francia, Jennifer Hayashida, Evelyn Hudi Hart, Peter Kang, Amitabha Kumar, Peter Kwong, Kyo Lee, Conrad Ng, Betty Lee Sung, Jack Chen, and David Yu. So let's give everyone a hand, and without your support and your dollars, we won't survive. Thank you.